You didn't think I was going to play a series known for hunting down the gods themselves to duke it out with them in the form of bosses and not rank them, right? Really, I've toyed with a lot of different projects over the years, but I think if I were known as anything, it'd be that boss ranking guy on YouTube. And by the gods, I've missed making them. There's just something about talking about the dire straits of a shit boss or the enormous satisfaction of a phenomenal boss to everything in between. Coincidentally, I'm in luck because the quality of the bosses in the God of War series could not be more all over the place. Even better, we're starting with the biggest thinker in the franchise, God of War Ascension. That is unless God of War 2018 somehow ends up being terrible. It better not. I'll be ranking the series bosses by game and on their quality, not their difficulty. Of course, I'll be taking the enjoyability of the difficulty into account, as I will with the design of the fight, the story setting the stage, and the ever-important fun factor. One final note before we get started. I'm going by the wiki definition of what is and isn't a boss. These definitions are somewhat generous, so forgive me if some of these selections seem lackluster and outside the normal consideration for what a boss is. Let's just all agree to blame Ascension. Without further ado, here are the God of War Ascension bosses ranked from worst to best. Coming into the distant last place, barely picking up a participation trophy for showing up as the Manticore. First, this is basically a souped up normal enemy. You know in Dark Souls when you see an early game boss as an enemy later in the game and think to yourself, wow, that's fucking lazy. Here it's more along the lines of seeing a boss that is essentially a big enemy and thinking to yourself, wow, that's fucking disappointing. Then again, if you think about it, all bosses are just big enemies anyway, or at least they have bigger HP bars and a wider variety of attacks. But this flying mishmash of predators doesn't have all that many interesting attacks, it's not very fun to fight, there's no story purpose for it whatsoever other than, hey, here's this tower and this thing is guarding it. And to put the cherry on top of this shitbird, you get to fight two of them in the game, because we all know I love me some reskins. Speaking of which, what a grand decision it was to reuse these furious sisters throughout multiple different boss fights in the game. Granted, they are big bad, so it's somewhat excusable, but this game's mediocrity makes me grumpy, so screw it! You suck, Tisiphone! What was that, T-Mod? Did you just say this boss is some kind of phone? No? Well, maybe. We need to get the elephant out of the room now. I have a unique way of pronouncing things. It was bad enough when I was using basic words however I damn well Vicard, but now I gotta pronounce Greek mythological words. Anyway, this fight is a lot less exciting to play than it is to look at. Electo, the Queen of the Furies, turns into a giant aquatic monster that relies more on smacking arbitrary tentacles while being in little to no danger, and flashy quicktime events in actual meaningful combat. And I know that God of War is famous for popularizing quicktime events. I also want to put it out there that I do not hate quicktime events and personally believe they get a little bit more flack than they deserve. They serve as a way to make the player feel involved in a cinematic scene that only can work while the camera is on rails. But there are many ways to implement it, and when you make it a large focus of the fight, it becomes an annoyance even if it does look cool. There is one part of the fight where you do come face to face with Electo, but then that phone lady is up your butt too, and we've already fought her, so bah humbug. All in all, it's not terrible, but not overly satisfying to play due to its on-the-rail natures and lack of stimulating mechanics. Would you look at that? The phone is back in her original appearance in the game, accompanied by another fury we've already fought before. I'm only kidding, this fight isn't so bad. The intro portion with you being thrown into an illusionary battle with Spartan warriors sets a cool stage, and fighting through them to get to Megara is an interesting dynamic. Once you clear this portion, you get to fight the Furies in a 2v1 battle that's cool enough, but honestly, there's nothing at all remarkable I have to say about it. I think this fight reminds me exactly how I feel about Ascension as a whole. It's remarkably average in every way, shape, and form. The story is average, the combat is average, the enemy variety is average, the level design is average, and this boss is the goddamn average of this ranking! Oh god, look at this Siamese monstrosity!
What's in the basket?
Despite their unsightly appearance, these twins boast the honor of being one of the two worthwhile bosses in an otherwise unremarkable experience. The most valuable part of Pollux and Castor's design is their ability to manipulate time. Throughout the battle, you'll find yourself avoiding the arena as it decays in the middle of your fight, destroying decrepit pillars in order to stop the boss from fleeing, and even dealing with a slowdown of Kratos himself mid-combat. The boss has multiple phases, and a good amount of well-designed attacks for you to handle and balance with blows of your own. And quick-time events are sparse and flashy in all the right ways when they come around. You're even rewarded greatly for the fight. No, I don't mean the amulet of Oba Bubbas. I mean getting to curb stomp Castor. An overall pleasant fight that doesn't suffer from many of the mundane aspects of previous bosses on our list, but still fair to say that it doesn't achieve any marvelous heights. The closest thing to something like that would be Aegion and Megara, which takes place in the opening of the game. It's no wonder it's easy to judge the rest of the game harshly when you realize it blows its load right in the first few minutes. This entire beginning sequence could be considered a long-running boss fight, which gives it the advantage of some incredible variety. The The scale of the fight works well. The boss has platforming sequences, well-played quick time events, timed damage expectations, multiple different phases, and fair, reasonably straightforward attacks that are varied throughout and balanced well for what is essentially a tutorial. It is well above average and gives you so much hope and promise for the adventure ahead. What a shame. What are your favorite Ascension bosses? Tell me in the comments below. I realize this video is on the short end, but I don't want to stretch out the videos unnecessarily since many of these games only have a handful of bosses. I hope you enjoyed today's video nonetheless, and I strongly encourage you to check out the God of War Demodathon both here on YouTube and Twitch if you have the time to visit us live. And of course, thanks for watching, much love to you all, and I'll see you next time with Chains of Olympus.